Hi, are you one of those students who really struggle to solve difficult level GMAT questions on number properties, specifically on even and odd? If yes, you have come to the right video. In this video, I'll be solving a medium to difficult level GMAT question on number properties, specifically on the topic of even and odd. Secondly, I'll tell you how to solve data sufficiency questions when it comes to the GMAT. And thirdly, I'll be talking about some good habits and mainly process skills that would really help you solve questions in a much better format and with a very high accuracy. So let's get started. Now, before solving this question, I would also recommend you to watch the video that I'd created on even and odd concepts. And that video, contains all the concepts that are tested on the GMAT when it comes to even and odd numbers. So, the link for that video is in the description box below. You can also get that link over the top right corner over here, right? And we also post a lot of content on our YouTube channel. And to never miss an update, make sure you subscribe to that channel with this link over here. So let's move into the question. In the question, what we have a DS question, and it's asking whether the expression have a very complex expression, which is essentially the difference of two quantities. And it's asked whether this expression is odd or not, where a, b, c, and d are non-negative integers, and a is less than b, which is less than c, which is less than d. Now, this is a DS question, and we have been given two statements, and I already hope that you people know the options that we have for a DS question. In case you do not, I will just take my video over here. You can pause the video and watch out the options, solve this question at your end, and then resume from this point. So let me take my video over here and let's begin solving this question. Now, the one thing that you have to keep in mind while solving a DS question is, there are certain things that the question stem wants to tell you. If you infer that information, if you understand this information, that would really help you solve DS questions a lot faster. If you do not, it might trouble you a lot. So in this question as well, we are first going to analyze the question stem. The question gives me a complex expression, which is essentially the difference of two different expressions. So I need to find out whether this expression is odd or not. Now, the expression that is given to me is 5b to the power 7 times c to the power 4 minus 10a to the power 3 times d to the power 5. And it's asked whether this is odd or not. Now, I know that I can write this very simplistically. I can write this as 5 times b times c minus 10 times a times d. And the question is asking me whether this is odd or not. Now, essentially, I can write this because I've talked about this, in that concept video as well. So if not gone through that, please, I recommend you to go through that. Power does not change the even odd nature of the variables that we have in the question. So essentially, b to the power 7's even odd nature is same as b. Similarly, c to the power 4's even odd nature is same as c. So essentially, now I have a very simple expression, and we can now move forward to simplify it further. Now, 10 times a times d, 10, which is an even number, is multiplied with two non-negative integers. Essentially, this product is also an even number in nature. So what do I have? I have 5 times b times c minus an even number, which is odd according to the question. So the question is asking me whether 5 times b times c is odd plus even, or whether 5 times b times c is odd or not. So this is what the question is asking. Now, from that complex an expression, we reach to this simple an expression. And this is where we say that, okay, 5 is an odd number. So 5 times b times c is odd. That essentially also means whether b times c is odd or not. So this is the simplification process that we applied before moving into the analysis of statements 1 and 2. And that, when you inculcate within your habits, solving DS questions would really become very easy for all of you. Now that we have b times c is odd or not, this becomes a yes or no question, and this is something that you need to infer. Any statement that tells me whether b times c is odd is a sufficient statement to answer this question. A very important process skill that we had used to solve this question is translation. And translation, along with simplification and inference, are three of those process skills that we have, which help us solve questions with much more accuracy and within a very limited amount of time. To know about these process skills in a much better format, I would rather recommend you to watch the videos on process skills that we have. To watch those videos, you can go to the description box below or click on the link that has just popped up on the top right corner. So let's now move forward with this information where whether B times C is odd or not. The first statement tells me A, B, C, and D are consecutive integers. Now, let me take some random numbers and let's just check what if A, B, C, D are consecutive integers, what are the even odd natures of B and C? Now, if I take 1, 2, 3, 4, you know, let's take B to be 2, C to be 3. If I take 2, 3, 4, 5, B to be 3, C to be 4, what we can see over here is there are two possible cases. You know, either B is even, C is odd, or B is odd, C is even. So one of B and C, B or C, is always even in nature. This is the inference that you, you know, have to do in this question. Once you do that, and once you know that one of B and C is always even in nature, the product is always going to be even. So that means my first statement is a sufficient statement to answer the question, because I had to answer whether B times C is odd or not. And since the first statement is sufficient, out of the five answer choices that I have, B, C, and E already gets eliminated. So the two answer choices that I have with me is now A and D. With that, let's move ahead and solve and analyze the second statement. The second statement tells me that 5 times C to the power 4a is odd in nature. Now, this does not provide me any information on B. So can I say B times C is odd or not? You know, the only information that I need is whether C is even. If C is even, I can say yes, B times C is not odd. So what I need to check, you know, essentially over here is if this statement gives me a validity whether C is even or not. If that does, then my statement is a sufficient statement to answer this question. The process skill used over here was translation, a very important process skill to solve DS questions specifically. Let's move ahead. So the second statement tells me 5 times C to the power 4a is odd, right? And I need to check whether this statement confirms C to be even or not. So there are two possible cases. Since A is a non-negative integer, A can either be equal to 0 or A can be greater than 0. If A is equal to 0, then what happens is 4a becomes 0, and any number raised to the power 0, any non-negative integer raised to the power 0 is always equal to 1. So 5 times 1 becomes 5, which is odd in nature. But we do not have any information on the even odd nature of C. So we cannot comment on anything as of yet. Let's move into the second case, which is A greater than 0. In this case, what we have over here is 5 times C to the power 4a, that's given as odd. Now, we know that powers does not change the even odd nature, and that is the reason we can write this as 5c. If 5c is odd, that essentially means that C is odd in nature. And, you know, if C is odd in nature from this case and C can be odd or even from the first case, we cannot say for sure that C is even in nature. And that is the reason why the second statement is not a sufficient statement. Now, if the first statement is sufficient, the second is not, we have to eliminate answer choice D, which means the correct answer choice for this question is choice A. I hope the entire process of solving this question is crystal clear to all of you. Right? I have two more practice questions for all of you now. I'll take my video over here so that you can pause the video and check out these two questions. Analyze the question statements properly, use the process skills, and I want you people to solve these questions and post the answers on the comment section below, right? With that, I would also tell you that we post content and we will be posting a lot of content on GMAT number properties, on prime numbers, on divisibility and remainders. So to stay updated with all that content, make sure you subscribe to the channel and you get a notification so that you do not miss out on that. Till the next time we meet, have a very good day ahead, and have happy learning, all of you.